Though it occurred more than 40 years ago, the Iranian Revolution completely changed Iran and the region even into today. Hello, my name is David and this is Eurasia. Without further ado, let's get into the causes of the Iranian Revolution. The five major causes of the Iranian Revolution can be summed up in the acronym CLUES. In 1953, the nationalization of the Iranian sector of the British Petroleum Company from the democratically elected Prime Minister of Iran, Mohammad Mossadegh, pushed a British-American special ops coalition to overthrow him and replace him with the Western-friendly Fazollah Zahidi. Then, 20 years later, in 1973, a large Arab coalition grouped up and placed an oil embargo on the West in order to punish Western countries for supporting Israel in the Yom Kippur War. Iran did not join the Arabs in this embargo, and this angered many citizens around Iran. On the other hand, Iran enjoyed the spoils of tripled oil prices, all while exporting all the oil it could produce. Yet, the Shah did nothing with the extra profits except spend it on luxuries. Probably due to the embargo profits running dry, Iran experienced a major recession 5 years later from 1977 to 1978. Though the Shah continued to live luxuriously, everyday people were affected greatly. Since the fall of the Qajar Empire in 1925, Western countries, namely Russia, the UK, the United States, and France, conducted many indirect and direct policies in Iran in order to westernize the country. By the 1970s, to the distress of many, many Iranians had forgotten the culture and history of the Persian people. Lastly, as already seen, the Shah was no more than a Western puppet by the end of the 1970s. He often consulted with the American and British diplomats before conducting foreign or domestic policy, and many of these policies were in Western interest and thus left the everyday Iranian to fend for themselves. Therefore, it is no wonder that one of the most sidelined groups in Iran were the religious communities. Of them, one prominent cleric named Ruhollah Mousavi Khomeini had been arrested in 1963 for denouncing the Shah, and, after being hit by the Prime Minister of Iran himself in 1964, went into exile in Turkey, Iraq, and France. During the 30 years leading up to 1979, Khomeini made a name for himself in the increasingly targeted Iranian Islamic community. In January of 1978, when an article was written in the national newspaper, ironically calling Khomeini a British agent, the many people who Khomeini had positively impacted since his childhood started protesting against the article and, later, against the Shah himself. Skipping over many details, the Shah's response to each and every protest only let them grow in numbers. By the summer of 1978, nearly every major city had crowds of tens of thousands of angered Khomeini supporters. By August, the crowds grew to hundreds of thousands of people. And by September, martial law was declared in nearly all major cities in Iran, including Tehran. On November 6, 1978, after replacing the civilian government with a military government, the Shah broadcasted to the Iranian nation that he was willing to talk and collaborate with opposition leaders and create a more democratic state in Iran. Like all of the Shah's policies, this backfired when the protesters sensed weakness and defeat from the Shah. Khomeini officially called upon his supporters to overthrow the Shah on the same day. In what is nicknamed the Muharram protest, December saw more than 10% of all Iranians taking to the streets demanding the Shah to step down. Within the next 2 months, the protest grew and grew, while the Shah did nothing to stop them. During these 2 months, when it became obvious that the Shah could not keep power for much longer, American diplomats organized the Prime Minister, Shapur Bakhtiar, to take full control over the country and depose the Shah. This was done on January 16, 1979. And, on the same day, the Shah went into exile in Egypt. Bakhtiar released all political prisoners, invited the protesters into the government, and, most importantly, welcomed Khomeini back to Iran. Bakhtiar concedingly wanted to create a Shia holy state in the holy city of Qom, where Khomeini could rule. Khomeini, on the other hand, was not playing into this. On February 1st, 1979, Khomeini arrived in Tehran, but quickly made his own government, to which Bakhtiar denounced. Within a few days of Khomeini's arrival, two governments were controlling Iran. After attacking a weapons depot on February 9th, Khomeini's supporters went directly after Bakhtiar. On February 11th, Bakhtiar fled Iran and his government collapsed. Khomeini successfully controlled the country and the monarchy was officially abolished. On March 31st, a national referendum was voted on in order to approve the current constitution of the Islamic Republic of Iran. 99% of voters supported. As many Western experts have stated, even if the referendum was conducted corruptedly, the results would have been the same. The vast majority of Iranians supported the Republic's foundation at the time, and though those numbers have waned since 1979, a good percentage of Iranians support their government and its policies today, as much as they did 40 years ago. Ayatollah Khomeini's sermons and teachings were put into practice. His criticisms of the Shah were, in theory, fixed in his own government, and his criticisms of the West and the Soviets, but especially the United States, continued as well. This would lead to the 1979 hostage crisis, which would make the already rocky relations between Khomeini's government and the US into full-out hot, when both the US and the Soviets supported Saddam's Iraq in invading Iran. From 1979 onwards, the split in American-Iranian relations would create an entirely new Middle East. Today, Iran has faced increased pressure to liberalize while also trying to withhold its conservative foundations, but this in itself deserves a video of its own. Truthfully though, the Iranian Revolution had dozens upon dozens of important impacts felt throughout the world, from the formation of modern terrorism to the support of Islamic Development Aid. Iran is, like everything in our world, both good and bad, and the causes, events, and aftermath of the Iranian Revolution show this well. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like the video, and of course, click the subscribe button as well. Until next time, stay happy, stay humble, stay hopeful, and goodbye.